Today in the EU, the heat under your feet is at the top of the Hungarian Council presidency's energy agenda. Although geothermal energy plays a small part of the EU's renewable energy mix, it has significant potential as a stable and local source in the Union's quest for energy independence. The topic has now resurfaced under the Hungarian EU Council presidency's push, and energy ministers will be talking about this type of energy in today's meeting in Budapest. But how does geothermal energy work? What are the pros and cons? And what could it mean for the EU? Hello and welcome. I am Vikiori and this is Today in the EU. Today we're joined in the studio by Nathan Canas, our energy and environment reporter. Hi, Nathan.
Hi.
This is your very first time in our podcast, so welcome.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
And today we're talking about geothermal energy. And I have to admit, I know nearly nothing about this. What is geothermal energy and how come we're talking about it now?
Okay. If right now we are talking about geothermal energy, it's because today the energy minister of the 27 EU member states are meeting in Budapest in Hungary. The first point on the agenda is the role of geothermal energy in the European energy mix. Following the adoption of a European Parliament resolution on this energy source in January 2024, the Council of the EU is considering the issue for the first time. What is geothermal energy? It's the use of the earth heat to produce energy, basically.
Very simply put.
Geothermal energy emits no greenhouse gases and it's raw material. The heat of the earth is totally free. You can find it anywhere.
So this could be a very interesting energy source for Europe, potentially helping in the Union's quest for energy independence. We've heard about this a lot during the previous years. But what are the advantages and disadvantages of geothermal energy?
First of all, geothermal energy produces just 0.2% of electricity in the entire EU in 2022.
So it's a small step.
Oh, yeah. And despite this, geothermal energy provides electricity that is produced locally, continually, and available all year round, regardless of climatic condition. What are the advantages? It emits very few greenhouse gases compared with fossil fuels.
More than 70% of heating in particular and cooling in the EU is based on fossil fuels. So again, the potential for decarbonization is high. While this potential is high, we have seen rather slow progress over the last years. Net Zero Industry Act, that is more the manufacturing rather than deployment side. Geothermal is one of the technologies supported by it. That requirement pushes the member states, the local authorities to map their potential.
Said this past June, Lukas Kolinski from the European Commission's DG Ener.
And make it an active contributor to the fight against global warming. That's a clear ally against global warming.
That's very interesting. But how does this really work in practice?
Okay, so basically we have like three different type of geothermal energy. The first one is the high energy geothermal power for electricity generation. Basically is to extract high pressure stream around 150 250 degrees at a depth of 2,500 meters, really deep, which can be used directly to drive turbines and generate electricity. The second time, it's low energy geothermal system. It's between 30 to 150 degrees at a depth of 100 meters or 2,000. And focus on the groundwater at intermediate temperature that is inappropriate for power generation, but can be used directly for district heating via geothermal heating network. For example, for an entire city or just a neighborhood. And the last one is the very low energy geothermal. This extracts tertial heat present at a swallow depth in the ground. It's between 10 and 100 meters, and it's using a heat pump for individual homes.
You mentioned some degrees, some numbers of degrees. What does that really mean? Because I'm not an expert on this.
So basically, deeper you are going in the ground, hotter is the temperature. And closer to the surface, you will find like water. And this water, you can use it directly to heat your neighborhood, your home, or public administration, for example. Then it's the same thing for a house. You will use like this ambient temperature to heat your house. But then you can go like really deep, like maybe like 5,000 meter into the ground. And there you can use like the pressure steam to produce electricity.
And what about the sustainability aspect of this?
Okay, the reason why this form of energy is rarely exploited is that it's very expensive to operate. It costs several million euros to drill deep into the ground, and to be honest, without being sure of being able to exploit the heat. The average cost of a geothermal system for heat pump for a private home, if for example you want to install this type of system, is between 12,000 and 15,000 euro. And the return on investment is often long. That's why not a lot of people or public administration bet on this type of energy.
And from an environmental perspective?
Geothermal energy can entail risk for environment. We have to talk about it because it's such as we have, and there is impact of exploration activities with the risk of seismic activities or ground collapse. We have also possible interference with groundwater and its contamination. Then we have the release of gas emission trapped in the earth. And finally, it's one of the couple examples I can mention, is the overexploitation of thermal water resources. I can give an example of what are the risks of this type of energy. I come from a region in France called Auvergne, in the center of France. It's known for its dormant volcanoes. And I know that locals have opposed geothermal project for fears of waking them up. But why, like, we still have a strong opposition for local people.
And it can happen that they try to drill, but they end up understanding that there is no geothermal energy whatsoever underneath.
Exactly. And imagine you are investing like million of euro and finally you have nothing. That's why not a lot of people bet on that.
And what's worth mentioning about this newfound interest is that the Hungarian presidency has now put this at the top of the agenda. Can you tell us exactly why?
To be honest, if it wasn't for the Hungarians, for example, the next presidency, the Polish one, would have put it on the agenda.
The source of renewable heat that is perhaps still not one of the big technologies, but it's a growing technology and it's a technology with a high potential. And I think this is very much reflected in the overall policy that we have at the European level. I think it's also reflected in the increased interest of the policymakers in the topic, with the report prepared by the previous parliament. And now I see and I hear also quite some interest from the Hungarian presidency.
Explain, Lukasz Kolinski, about the advantages of geothermal energy.
Because right now, several member states have already set up a strategy to develop geothermal energy at national level. I can mention, like, for example, Germany, Poland, Austria, Ireland, Croatia, Hungary, of course, and France. And I know that France wish aims to be the leader in that field, like, you know, to have on one hand nuclear energy and on the other hand, like geothermal for public administration or cities. This country wants a European legislative framework to be put in place and also, of course, with subsidies for its development.
Right. And what are the main bullet points the ministers will be discussing in today's meeting in Budapest?
We already know that the ministers are invited to share their views on some question, mm-hmm. or one of them will be like how to improve the commercial viability of geothermal investment in general. Another point will be how to raise public awareness mm-hmm. for geothermal energy. Another one will be how to speed up cooperation between member states, because some of them have already installed this type of geothermal system, and it's a way mm-hmm. to share like techniques. And also, of course, it's a strategy for coal region, because maybe I can talk a little bit more about that, is that geothermal energy, if you have like a former mine, like a coal mine, and it's closed since like decades, mm-hmm. you can use it for geothermal energy because you have already your...
The infrastructure.
Exactly. You have already the infrastructure and you can already get all this temperature from the ground. And I mean, country like Poland or, for example, the north of France, where you have this really old coal mine, mm-hmm. or even Germany, mm-hmm. You can use this system to heat an entire city. And it's really cool.
Yeah. Do you see Europe changing the direction towards this energy, or are we talking about a phase that will pass with the end of the Hungarian presidency?
I think it will pass during the Hungarian presidency because everybody wants to invest and push for this technology. I know that in September, the Energy Council working group will begin drafting the text, mm-hmm. and that while awaiting the Commission's proposal. Following this, the Budapest Geothermal Energy Summit will be held on 20 September of mm-hmm. this year.
And you already mentioned examples of places where we can find this energy, but do you have any examples of where this energy is already used?
Of course, you can find this type of energy everywhere. Mm-hmm. One country where is using it a lot is, and is famous for that, it's Iceland, because with all these volcanoes. But for more European Union focus, I would mention for again my home country, France, with the Élysée presidential palace is heated by geothermal energy. And here in Brussels, we have like the headquarters of NATO. Mm-hmm. It's also for security reason, because like that you have like your own heating system and you are out of the grid. That means mm-hmm. if someone, I don't know, cut the grid, you will still have like mm-hmm. energy for your building.
So in case of power outages, they are relying on geothermal energy then.
Exactly, because mm-hmm. you are getting this energy directly from your own ground under the building. And then like another example would be like the House of European History.
Thank you, Nathan. And we will be following your reporting on this. I am Evi Kiori, and this was Today in the EU podcast. Visit Euractiv to stay up of the latest news, sign up for our podcast newsletter, and if you haven't subscribed yet, you can find us on all streaming platforms. And please make sure to leave a comment or a review on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Your reviews help us a lot to spread the word about our work. This episode was produced by Nicoletta Yonda and me. Thank you for tuning in, and until tomorrow morning. As part of our commitment to accuracy, inclusion and transparency, Euractiv is part of the Trust Project.